Call the meeting to order at 18:03. South County EMS Board of Oversight, regular monthly meeting. We have a motion on the minutes as emailed.
Make a motion to accept the minutes.
Second.
Discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
I can't vote because I wasn't here.
Zach?
Yeah.
Want to start out with your monthly report?
I'm just trying to pick it up. All right. Monthly report. One of those good months where there isn't much to report on. So, no news is good news when you're in the emergency business, yes? I guess operational-wise, Leverett, they get their EMS coverage from Amherst Fire. They're still happy with them, but their next mutual aid ambulance after Amherst is Medcare. And they've had increasing frustrations, and I guess recently they had some call and there was some ridiculously long amount of time for Medcare to respond. So, talking with them, looking at the number of calls, the amount of times gone to mutual aid, we've actually been upgraded on their mutual aid list above Medcare now. We're geographically closer, we're paramedic level, we made that change. I don't foresee that having any significant or any impact really at all on our call volume. It's pretty minimal. They do so few calls a year, and Amherst is usually always there, so. Let's see. Talking about our mentor program at South County EMS, that's a term, but we have a cadre of the full-time staff who have been designated the mentors, and this is a completely voluntary responsibility they take on, and basically they embody the values of South County EMS. They have a lot of experience in EMS, so they're the ones who make themselves available to the rest of the per diem staff, the call staff, the new EMTs, and mentor them. That's why we call them mentors. We actually recently, April Fernandez and Teresa Emerson, two of our full-time paramedics, have enthusiastically asked and agreed to be part of that mentoring staff, which is great, which means that we now have a mentor in every single one of our crews through the rotation. So when we have new EMTs, they have better opportunities to get that insight. And this is also the group of people that I meet with on a semi-regular basis every 6 weeks typically. And we talk about operational stuff, how things are going. They're really the eyes and the ears out on the front lines. So they tend to hear like the gripes and the feedback before it ever filters up to me. So excited to have them on board. And staying on staffing, Gary Ponce, one of our paramedics, he's actually the director up at Coleraine Volunteer Ambulance. He's been acknowledged and is going to receive the American Red Cross Hometown Hero Award this year for his efforts in pre-hospital emergency medicine and the way that he cares for patients. This is primarily based out of his work up in Coleraine, but obviously he's a paramedic here at South County full-time, and that was one of the reasons why he was tapped for that role early on, was that he really represents the best in EMS. So we're very excited to have Gary recognized that way. The ceremony's coming up, and I guess there's just a piece in the news, so we're going to be sharing that in the near future.
That's wonderful.
Yeah. Let's see. No delays on the replacement ambulance. Still March of this year. And we're currently right now just through kind of annual inspection preventive maintenance time for our current ambulances. So we're swapping those out. And I reached out to Mike just talking about a new facility. What type of dollar amount would he expect for, you know, outfitting everything? And he said he had a lot of good insight about the things that kind of sneak up on you. And he put the estimate about $20,000 or $30,000, and that's soup to nuts. That's everything from an office chair to the waste basket bin outside to the vacuum cleaner, all that stuff. So I felt confident and comfortable with that with that number.
That includes IT?
Yes, I think, yeah, yeah.
Really?
Well, a couple computers. I mean, we're not talking about a server.
And a phone system, and, I mean, it's not what's in your living room.
Right, well, that I don't know.
Okay.
That I don't know. I had no idea where to start with a number with this, so.
It's going to be a nut.
Seth, we bought some computers, wasn't it last year and the year before? So those are the tough books.
Yes, the patient care report computers that go in the
ambulance. So when you came to capital expenditure, did you put down for the new computers then? New desktops or anything like that?
I didn't do anything in the, I left a blank capital request for like facility needs, but I didn't know what amount or where to begin. At the most recent budget that I submitted, I plugged that 20 to 30 in for facility stuff, so.
Okay.
Antifreeze. All right. End of the world. All right. I met with Joe Markarian again from FERCOG. He had some wrap-up questions. He didn't give me any sort of insight as, you know, his report or anything. Not that he needed to or should have, but it sounded like he was nearing the end and kind of formulating his conclusions.
Did you have any indication what his recommendations might be?
No. I mean, there's kind of some particular questions, like, why is your budget, like, the spreadsheet set up the way it is? Why is this number shown in this category and not another? And to wit, I answered, well, this was the spreadsheet that was given to me. If there's a smarter way to do it, then by all means, I would love to do it or whatever. But he wasn't making any sort of actual recommendations at that moment, just had those types of questions. So I believe, you know, things like pulling out overtime numbers into a separate line item. Right now they're factored into the base salary, stuff like that. So some housekeeping, things like that.
Okay.
Speaking of the budget, the most recent one updated today. I got numbers from Barbara Hancock yesterday as far as county retirement and things like that. So I'd like to, I think this is probably as good as you're going to get from me. I'd like the board to look at it, weigh in.
You want to go down line by line and give us?
Sure.
Budget.
Sure. Briefly, salaries and wages, employee benefits. This is based off of the calculations of our staffing models and grades and steps for the following year. So that's all based on those number calculations. When we get down into employee benefits, the retirement amount is less than what I had calculated. I think my original number was 90,000 something. Barbara said they're only going to bill us 78,215, so that's been lowered.
Zach, on salaries and wages,
yeah.
Is there any way that we could separate the overtime from the regular?
Absolutely.
And again, that helps us understand what's happened with that?
Yeah, I've got a separate worksheet with all of these personnel costs broke down by hour, by all that stuff. So that's...
what's our breakdown on... What do we have for paramedic staff, EMT staff? Do you have that number?
By hour, by
no, just how many? How many EMTs or how many paramedics that we have?
Full-time staff, we have, including myself, 8 paramedics, 1 EMT advanced.
Okay.
And per diem staff, let me see here. I got 20. Sorry about that. 26, 21, Doing some math. 11. So I got another 12 paramedics per diem. One additional advanced EMT per diem. And then 17 EMT basics.
Good. So if I'm reading this correctly and listening to you, the full-time staff that you just mentioned, that increase is an 8.5% increase. But part of that is based upon additional shifts?
So the staff, that 8-point-something increase, you'll see there's a decrease in the call staff there.
Yeah.
That is, I'm budgeting high on this for the discussion, and this is actually something that came up with Joe Markarian. We're talking about the clerical duties and things like that. This is the numbers reflective of the what I supplied last meeting. The additional full-time staff member. It's an
And I'm sorry, it's 9.15, 9.2% increase.
It's
9.2. 9.
Yeah, 5. It's. It was an extra $15,000 a year for that extra full-time person. So I've calculated that in here as like looking forward, not sure what was going to happen. So this is the high end.
So my question is, what percent raise are the full-time people getting? Because I see, you know, I hate to get personal here, but I see the director's salary going up 8.5% from fiscal 17 to fiscal 18.
That is, that's a COLA rounding of 2% based on what my salary was voted for this fiscal year.
It's 8.5% increase.
It should
overall.
Be. It shouldn't be 70 right now. It should be 75.
Oh. Why is it incorrect on the?
We voted last September to forward it to the Deerfield Personnel Committee, and they have not acted on it yet. Our recommendation was to raise him up
to
75.
So it's still 7. So it will be from one fiscal year to the next. It will be 8.5%.
So he'd be going from 75 to 76,500.
But if they haven't acted on it yet, that's what I'm confused about.
We haven't had a personnel committee full form personnel.
When was the vote to raise the salary? And I'm not disputing the merits. I'm just saying, when was the vote to raise to 75 taken?
September 22nd, 2016.
Okay. And there's been no quorum for 4 months? Four and a half months?
There hasn't.
There was. The two times where there were, nobody went there.
Yeah.
That's what it was.
What
we
do you
meet
mean,
once a month, and they had quorum twice, and no one went with the packet of information as per requested. And then the one time, or two times, other times, they have not had a quorum. So that's why it has not been acted on. It's part of our personnel bylaws.
Thank you.
So the full-time staff numbers, the call staff, I've got the breakdown on a separate spreadsheet. Like I said, this is for the additional full-time staff member, less the overnight call. And it's a difference of, what did I say, 15,000? Thank you, annually. So I put that number in only because I didn't know what the recommendations of Joe Markarian and or the actions of this board were gonna be in the future, so I wanted to anticipate that potentially.
One of the things that I was hoping that we could do was to pull out the overtime. To date, we've had about $66,000 in overtime. And our full-time staff were about 66% spent when we should be about 60% spent. So we're overspending the line item. And I was hoping that we would be able to reach out to call staff that and supplement call staff. You know, this has been ongoing since September that we've been, you know, overspending that line item. And so I was hoping that, Zach, we could reach out to call staff and let them, and instead of using overtime, mm-hmm. use call staff so that we can make up this budget line.
Yeah, absolutely. All of our open shifts always go to call staff first, always. And we schedule a month out, and we only go to overtime if we're within a few days.
Okay, well, maybe we can make more of an effort to reach out. I was just concerned about the overspending on that line, but also from a capacity point of view, if mm-hmm. we had a major event, you know, if we're not utilizing our call staff, per diem staff, then we're not, you know, going to be able to have as much capacity, you know, because they're not used to working as much. You know,
sure.
Not, you know, if you haven't been doing it for a couple months, you just, you know, a couple months goes into another
yep.
couple months,
yep.
and pretty soon they're just not.
Yeah, and our mentors, I mean, that's part of their job, is to keep those people engaged. All of our call staff, because they're paramedics and professionals, they have full-time jobs elsewhere, right. and that's usually what it boils down to, is that we schedule a month out so they can plan their lives, but, you know, come 2 days out, we get a sick call out, you know, 4 hours from now, you know, we panic and try to fill it, and that's usually when you see the overtime, is that if we don't have somebody who can take it.
But we have had this conversation before. And I don't know what's happening or not happening as far as getting the per diem people in there, but it seems like, you know, the same type of individuals continually rack up this overtime.
Yeah. So the person you're talking about that you're identifying as using the majority of the overtime, that individual, there's two reasons why. One is that person's been delegated a lot of responsibilities that they had been doing previously, and they have to fit in, and they take those responsibilities on. I don't have somebody else, like a clerical person or somebody that's available to do these things. So there's additional duties that person's taken on. And also, they're usually more enthusiastic about working additional hours. So it's offered to all the staff, but this one particular person chooses to work it when the other staff.
But the problem is we end up spending more money to do that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we're not getting more coverage. So, you know, if I would suggest that maybe that person not be delegated so much, or if they have to be out of the bus, if you will, get somebody else to fill in.
Right.
And,
well,
and do it ahead of time, because otherwise I see the scenario just not changing.
You know? You're absolutely 100% right. And that's what I've been talking about with the capacity in the system. So, yeah, I mean, you're absolutely right.
Zach, I know you've had some issues with people being out sick and stuff, but it was just that the $66,000 is approximately 25% of your salary line, and,
mm-hmm.
and to have that be overtime is, I think that's out of kilter.
Sure.
We just have to try to get back in line.
Because it seems like people are taking a good chunk of sick days, and I get their owed. I'm just wondering whether you have a sense of, are people taking sick days as they are accrued, or and they're using the definition of sick liberally?
The problem that,
and I get they can do it, but
it's really the sick time. We have very little sick time used in the department, save for we have somebody who has to have emergency surgery or something like that, and they might be out for a week or two at a time.
Sure.
It's the main crux of all this was that open full-time position that we had for quite a long time, for 6 months of last year.
So it's not to cover sick shifts.
Not to some crazy degree. I mean, I've had one sick call out in the past 3 weeks,
okay.
maybe. So it's,
okay.
and that's in the middle of flu season. It's
okay. Thank you.
All right. Let's see. Going down through expenses. I think everything is basically the exact same as last year.
What's the plan to actual for this year, though? Because that'll, I mean, everything's flat.
So last year was budgeted 276,807. This year, 279.
I'm not asking that.
Oh,
I'm
sorry.
I'm saying what's budgeted, I see.
Yep.
What has been spent to date?
Oh, that's in your director's report. Yeah, here's a paper.
So are we? Do we think we're on plan, or do we think we're below targets, or what?
We are here, and that is the balance.
What would be helpful in for future budgets is to see a variance, but not the variance as it would be for the end of the year, but the variance is projected proportionally on a monthly basis, if you follow it. So if you're projecting, I'm just going to pick a random number, one of the smaller line items, if you're projecting medical equipment, which is budgeted at $6,800, if you take that over 12 months, it's, you know, whatever, $500 and change a month. So is it, are we spending to plan by on a month-to-month basis, or are we spending under plan? If we're spending under plan, that's great, but that'll help figure out whether the number for the next proposed fiscal year is accurate or not.
Yeah, there's, right.
Do you follow that?
I think so. There's a few things that we would expect to track out on a month-to-month: fuel, oxygen, medication, supplies. The other things, like the ambulance stuff here, the repairs, the maintenance, the
software. Right, I get that.
Fees.
I understand that. But the stuff that can be tracked because it's somewhat proportional.
That's
just helpful to see whether the request makes sense or
not.
Otherwise, it's okay.
Yeah,
it's a flat budget. Great, wonderful. But it doesn't, there's more to it. More to it than that.
Yeah, when I calculated these and adjusted them, they were based on previous years or to date when I could, if it was something like that.
Okay.
I think, what do we got changes in? Things like the radio service fee we talked about last meeting, that's gone up. Some software service fees, but generally speaking, everything is.
Zach, it looks like your workman's comp is really going up exponentially.
That is, we were twofold. One was, you'll notice down under SCEMS other payroll costs, Mega Property and Casualty Group, it would actually originally had been budgeted kind of twice, but was also under budgeted initially. So I don't know where the initial numbers came from, but now that we have a couple years of experience, these are the numbers coming from the clerk's office in Deerfield of our share of the workman's comp expense.
Actually, I have a number for workers' comp is $28,838.
That's right in between.
Instead of
$32,706. Great.
I just got that number today, Zach.
Okay, great. What is it?
It's $28,838. I got that from Brenda.
Okay.
I think it's, that's a little bit more accurate.
They usually base that on the salaries.
Yeah,
right, and salaries. The number of people who are working.
Yeah.
And I was also looking, Zach, at in the medical insurance, you're going to carry 14.6 as a contingency.
Medical insurance. Nope, you're looking. That's that was from 2017.
Okay, so you're not doing that this year.
We're not doing that this year. That represented the difference last year on my calculations, given the formula and what Barbara said. It was going to cost.
So now we're looking at 65,000?
No,
57.
But 68, we think.
So it's gone from 49 to 57.
Yeah. It's gone from
50,000 to 57.
We think the Hampshire Trust is going up.
It's going to be 10%.
10%. Yeah, I was going to 9.5%. Yeah.
something like that.
So you're combining, by figuring the fiscal 17, you're combining those two line items.
Looks like it.
And is that, but I guess I'm wondering if, is that the reason that it's 57, is those two line items have now been combined?
No, that is calculated from an estimation that we will be carrying three family, two plus one, and three single plans.
And that's an increase over the current?
Yes.
By a lot?
Well, last year I calculated even higher, and it was...
Right, but I'm just saying that if insurance is going up 10%, if you just use that straight 35.4 figure,
yep,
that brings you up to ballpark of $40,000, and I'm you know, south of $40,000.
Yep.
That means that an additional $17,000 is being carried by additional insured, which, if that's the carry, that's the carry. But I think again, to know what we're looking at, it would be helpful to know what that $17,000 is buying us. Mm-hmm. Is it buying us another family? Is it buying us a family and an individual? What's it buying us? And again, it's an employee benefit, and that's wonderful, and they deserve it. But just looking at the numbers is only half the story. It's what are we getting for the dollars? So if we can know that, again, $17,000, what's it buying? Is it two families? Is it? And again, I don't know the Deerfield healthcare plan.
Yep.
And I don't, you know, need to know. But what's it buying?
We're 65, 45.
No, I get that. But what's it buying? And we don't know what it's buying.
Yeah, I don't know how to.
Well, he just told you he got
three. But he told me total, but he didn't say what the add-on, what the addition was. That's what I'm.
Oh, okay, I see. Yeah. Oh, so jump from last year to this year.
Yeah, yeah. So what's the additional $17,000 buying? Not the total, not.
Yeah.
And whatever it is. But it'd be good to know what it's buying. That's my point. So we can justify the addition. Yeah. Because on a town meeting floor, somebody would see that and say, "What's that buying?" And we should be able to answer the question.
Well, I'm sure it's a number increase, right, Zach?
Right.
But
what is
it? You may be also curious.
Number of individuals plus increase in the plan.
Well, okay, but also a lot of times they'll put your treasurer, collector, whoever you have to do it will carry a contingency in case, and it'd be nice to know what that value is. Are we carrying enough? We're not carrying enough for future budgets also.
And I would agree with that, but Zach said that he took that line item out. So if we're going to do a contingency, that should, as it was last year, its own separate line item.
It could be.
Yeah.
Right. And that's the problem. That's the problem with the healthcare. You know, someone that right now is carrying a single may get married.
I get it.
And they have a family of five. You know, they marry someone with five children.
Right. Oh, I totally get it. It's just that he said that they're not doing that this year. And if they are, that's great, but it should be its own line item. So we really know the breakdown. That's my only point. It is what it is, but it's good to know how it works out. But he said that they're not doing contingency. Because otherwise that line item would have a value.
Typically, we always look at the budget line items that don't change from year to year. Usually that's, if they're not changing, that's where you usually find extra meat in the budget. So. We don't tell that to finance.
So, but you get my question.
Oh, yeah.
And I'm not trying to get out.
No, I got jest about it.
Yeah. Let's know what we're buying.
What do you think?
But that's what, you know, so sometimes people look at it and say the same as, hey, that's a good thing, but it's like, how can we stay the same for 6 years?
Because 6 years ago is a pretty good deal for the department.
Well, and again, you know, you're right, Jonathan. I mean, even on healthcare, you know, we've been very lucky over the last 3 or 4 years with the Hampshire's. I mean, they've pretty much held it pretty consistent at 2 or 3%, zero at some time. But they were actually taking money out of their reserves, and now they don't have a lot of reserves left, so.
Well, just the pharmaceuticals are going crazy.
Yep.
Yeah. Right, taking out of reserves sometimes comes back to bite you sometimes.
I'm not disagreeing.
Yeah.
Moving right along.
Moving right along. We're
permits, license fees, recertifications.
Permits, license fees. went up based on actual costs. We had originally budgeted 2,000. It looks like it's actually 2,300. And the recertifications, what's the change in that? Oh, that was, that additional $2,000 for travel expense was factored in because of mileage reimbursement for our staff traveling in between the stations every day. So I plugged that in. That's one trip back and forth every day isn't an additional $1,500. So that was that expense there.
The state rate or the federal rate?
That's the town rate, whatever. I don't know what the town pays. Or how they got their number. It's
we lag behind the federal rate, usually. We're a little bit behind. We review it once in a while, but we're usually a year or 2 years.
Federal rate this year will be 53.5 cents a mile.
Yeah, I think we're below that, Bruce.
I didn't know we get mileage for coming in.
Yeah.
No, but it is an unreimbursable business expense.
Yeah.
Yes.
It is.
It absolutely is.
What else?
If I can jump ahead,
please,
I don't know where you are.
Please.
And again, this is my newness to this, I guess. Collection fees is a new line item of 2000. What is collection fees?
Shouldn't...
It was there, and then it went away last year, and now it's back again. Is that an administrative fee?
That is... So that is a percentage... I don't know why it went away last year, quite frankly.
See if they can give me the...
That may have been lost because it's not...
I hope it's not a percentage because the cell doesn't have a formula attached. The cell is just a flat number.
No. You're right. I meant our fee that we charge for the billing company is a percentage of collections.
But that we charge, that would be a revenue stream, though.
They charge us. So I was confusing those things. Why did the collection fee disappear for last year? I don't know.
So what's the difference between a billing service and a collection? Wouldn't the collection fee just be looped into the billing service?
If the collections are done by a separate agency, right? Yeah. So
okay.
Or is the collections paid for if this is, if the CompStar can't do it instead of, we've gone and reviewed them and then are we paying someone separately to go after them again?
They just take a percentage of whatever they can collect. I don't think we've ever chosen to do that yet, though.
Yeah. Well, I know we talked about making a policy.
We haven't coordinated the three-time policy. Get anything in capital,
Zach? The capital expenses is on the separate worksheet. It was for FY17. The ambulance fund, $51,000 annually, and then the IV pumps and the stretcher load system. The Capital Improvement Planning Committee reviewed these things in Deerfield. And basically, the IV pumps are, what do they call it, unfunded mandate from the state? Yeah. So something we're expecting to have to purchase later on, so that's the money for that. And the stretcher load system is to... bring all of our ambulances up to the standard of the patient load system. All of that is being paid for out of the revenue over expenses. So that's a no cost to it in this assessment for those items.
You guys may have discussed this in previous fiscal years, but I'm going to suggest that perhaps we have a conversation about if it's a capital expense discussion, And I get why it goes to the Deerfield Capital Committee, but it may be wise to, and maybe it happened because I don't sit on Whately's Capital Committee, but it may be wise to give a heads up on what the capital requests are, because it's going to be borne by all three towns. And I just wonder whether, because it could impact, I mean, it's, you know, if yeah. one town is saying no to a lot of capital expenses, and all of a sudden we're in a position where we're saying yes to capital expenses because it's the shared thing. I mean, it's no different than Frontier. I just wonder whether it should be, because Frontier shares their capital requests mm-hmm. with all towns, and I just guess I wonder whether all capital requests should be shared, and it should be an, you know, just awareness.
Yeah.
I think that's a good idea, Jonathan.
I think it's worth discussing.
I mean, it's just, mm-hmm. I'm just thinking of a couple of our capital committee people would be like, what? We said no to everybody, you know, not that we said no to everybody else.
I have a question. You said capital for ambulance was 151,000?
51. That's our annual contribution.
Yeah. Right.
I thought it was 85.
51. If you want it to be 85?
No, I just thought it was 85.
No, 51.
So every 5 years you would have enough. But there is another capital item. Isn't there medical expense? 20,000 or something?
There's 21,000 for IV pumps, and then 20,000 for two of the auto load stretcher systems.
I thought you normally carried a capital that, set aside for.
We're not, that wasn't included this year, nothing like that.
Zach, what was it on the capital expense? It would probably be nice to see what your 5-year plan would be. I know you presented it to the Capital Committee in Deerfield, but I'm following up on Jonathan's comment, just putting out the 5-year plan so that everyone yeah. is aware of it is probably a really good idea.
No problem.
I know it's not a big deal, but it would probably be helpful so people had an idea of what the ongoing expenses would be.
Has there ever been a discussion about a stabilization account for capital that we control for SCEMS?
We kind of have one, but
is there any money in it, or is it just an account?
We have $100,000. Yeah.
Okay. Was that 1 month?
So, we're getting more comfortable with the budget. That's why we're asking more questions.
This is great.
And I hope so. Please understand. It's when I think that's good because yeah. now we're having a much more familiar.
Yeah.
Look at the budget, so we're understanding what's in the budget. That's why the question. So it's not a question about how the budget was put together. It's just
no. That's fine.
Okay.
Yeah, and this is an area that I don't have a lot of experience with. So that's meeting with Joe Markarian too, where he's like, "Why don't you have a line item for this? Like that sounds great. If that's how you know it should be done, and we want it. This is great."
So what Zach is alluding to, the town of Sunderland received a community compact grant for a regional study. Regional study. So we asked the FERCOG to do a study and make sure that what was happening with the South County EMS, the finances and how it's run and everything was consistent with the way we originally had talked about. Just and it was just because that you know that money was available, we thought it would be a value for all three communities. So that Joe and theoretically. He's supposed to talk to all members of the Board of Oversight, so you may get a call from him to talk, and you can express your concerns or thoughts with him as well. So we just thought it was a good idea to go ahead.
Yeah,
I think it's great. Revisit it.
Yeah. So he's going to reach out to each of the members also.
Do you want him to come to next month's meeting, or is his report going to be done before then?
Oh, we could ask. You could ask Sherry to ask him, Bobby. Sure. That'd be fine. I thought it was. We thought it was a good idea. Just to, and again, we need somebody that could have that 10,000 foot view of what's going on. Because mm-hmm. sometimes we get too close to it. So.
Tom, that was really nice of you to do that.
No, it was easy for us.
Okay.
Great.
You know.
In theory.
Yeah, I think so.
I'll tell you, the state right now has some monies available for community compact and stuff that are going to the community. It's well worth taking advantage of it if it's out there. And right now, one of the things they're looking at is regionalization and making regionalization better, so.
Did Deerfield's admin fee go up this year?
The what?
The administrative fee that Deerfield charges SCEMS, did that go up?
I did not adjust the amount in the budget.
Okay.
I didn't hear anything about it being recalculated.
There was a discussion the other night that might be recalculated. It's supposed to be recalculated every year.
Oh, it's going to be going down?
It might.
Come on.
He asked the question.
They can have $5 back. Kip, okay?
Whaley would charge less to SCEMS if we wanted to do that.
Yeah.
Absolutely we would. Just throwing it out there.
I know.
I think it's based on the bottom line, and if the bottom line doesn't change, it's not going to change, I don't think.
I think it's based on your budget.
It is.
It's based on your budget.
Yes.
And yours is going down. Well, don't add the school going up. Don't penalize us twice.
We can penalize.
No, don't penalize us twice.
8%.
8%?
8%. 5% increase for school plus the 3% budget.
No, you do, Kip.
I'll talk to you about that. Any other questions about the budget for Zach?
Zach, if I could say one thing on the presentation of the budget. I see where the numbers are coming from. Could you add another line either before or after the 2018 that would show the increase over the previous fiscal year in a percentage?
Mm-hmm.
That's easy enough, right? I mean, you just...
Yeah.
That way so we can look at what percentage is. And if you have something that goes up more than like 5% or pick a number, I mean, we can vote on it. Could you have maybe be able to discuss why it's going up that amount?
Yeah.
Thank you. Or more importantly, sometimes it may go down, you know, and going down is kind of an interesting thing to know why it happens also.
So there's no increase, right, Zach? I don't see anything.
There's no increase, and there's still revenue over expenses available. And this is where I feel the Board of Oversight especially needs to weigh in about what's best practice for that money. Is it completely 100% applied to the assessment for the towns, appreciating that, you know, next fiscal year, if our budget is still the same, we're going to see a market increase in the actual assessment. I don't know. This is.
I need to. That's a great question. I've looked at a lot of budgets in my life. I need to get a better sense of how the revenue over expenses spreadsheet put together, because when I looked at it, I choked because it reads as a. We're in the hole $240,000. Now, I get that that's not the case, but that's how it reads.
Yeah, right, yes. And that's...
And I don't want to choke.
Yeah, no, that's fine. I carried this over because the budget spreadsheet that I have always worked with, that I was presented, our revenue is a negative number because it's revenue against... That's how the Town of Deerfield budget spreadsheets work. So in order for these to jive, I made... this revenue also a negative number, so it would import directly into the budget spreadsheet, which is why they're in brackets.
But the enterprise fund balance, which a positive balance is a good thing,
correct,
reads as it is a $240,000 deficit, as it reads here. It's a fund balance and it reads as a deficit. So I'm just saying it would be great to...
I totally agree. It's only because the revenue...
Has it caught up?
No. It's because the revenue on our budget spreadsheet is listed as a negative number. That's all.
Right. But because it's a different, and also, I think they're creating it.
Jonathan, where are you?
What?
He's on the third tab of the budget. Okay. And that's this is under the thing of I'm learning as I go along. So my mistake if it's presented incorrectly.
My understanding is like Lee's estimated $410,000 roughly, right?
Oh, yeah, no, he's talking about something different.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. He's talking literally how I've shown the numbers in this spreadsheet, not what the numbers.
You mean on here?
No.
Or here?
So
what is he talking about? And the
remaining balance in the enterprise fund on June 30th, again, as I'm reading this, and maybe I'm not reading it correctly, was ballpark of $517,000 and a half.
Correct.
That's a 50.
And that was a carryover.
Yes.
Into fiscal 17, which isn't listed here.
Right.
But it says the carryover is into fiscal 18 usage, which we haven't started with fiscal 18 yet. So there's a whole fiscal year missing here. And then, and we're not even in fiscal 18 yet, but the balance is no longer 517,405, but rather 240,000.
Right, so because what had happened was we were one fiscal year behind because the retained earnings or whatever wasn't certified until we were into the next fiscal year. So we didn't use that money or apply it to the next fiscal year. So we've been, so 2015's fiscal year retained earnings were applied to 2017. 2016 is being applied to 2018.
Your auditor's going to work overtime on this puppy.
No, it's the auditors that did it, though.
No, the auditors don't do this. The auditors check the books. The auditors don't do this.
Yeah, well,
the auditors made us do
even
that.
Then, if this is a chance for us to keep up or catch up, as of, you know, whenever, this is the balance sitting in the enterprise book.
240.
517.
Mm-hmm. Okay, yeah. That's fine, but what's the 240 then?
240, because some of the, so...
Is that anticipated at the end of fiscal 18? That's what the carryover is going
to
be?
So how much did we use last, year to offset the total budget? Was it like
something like that, out of FY15.
So yeah. Are you planning using retained earnings to offset the budget again this year?
So that's my...
That's your question.
That's my question.
I thought that's what your question.
Yeah.
So we have to know how much... I guess we have to know how much we have in the retained earnings compared to last year, and are we staying even, or are we dropping that total number?
Well, he's got it written down here on the budget page. Revenue from services and retained earnings, $546,405. That's taking off the $1.153 million. So the service is actually $607,000.
On the books of the taxpayers.
And that's what gets divided up three ways.
Right.
So the 546,405 is the money that we're getting to revenue.
Revenue and retained earnings.
And the retained, see, I and again, I'm just trying to understand. I'm not doubting anything, but the confusing part is that, you know, this is somewhat similar to
Free cash.
Right. So, but free cash goes from fiscal 15 to fiscal 16 to fiscal 17 to fiscal 18. This isn't doing that on the sheet that we have here.
Yep.
And that's the root of the confusion. I don't know what the carryover was because we're jumping from fiscal 16 to fiscal 18, and it reads like fiscal 18's already happened.
Mm-hmm.
And fiscal 18, that's what we're planning for now.
Right.
So I don't know. So to Tom's question about what's being carried over, we have by this sheet, it's hard to tell.
Sure.
So can we get clarity or?
I mean,
I'm not saying now.
Yeah, no, but I'm saying that like this is the question, especially for the town accountant to be like, because I'm going off of the information I have about the enterprise fund, the reports I get from her and stuff like that, and trying to make hay out of it. So
your enterprise fund shouldn't really be changing during the year because you don't know I mean, it is what it is. You don't know until you do your recap at the end of the year what that enterprise fund has in it.
The entire budget's the enterprise fund.
What's that?
The entire budget is in the enterprise fund. This is an enterprise fund. The entire budget. So is that for the revenue?
Right. He's saying the equivalent of the free cash. Is that right, Tom?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Retained earnings.
The retained earnings. Yeah. The retained earnings shouldn't. We're not like a town where if we could have a special and say we need to dip to $50,000 on free cash. Okay. We don't do that here.
You can't do it.
Okay.
Retained earnings.
So the retained earnings should, what we go into fiscal whatever with after we've used whatever, X to offset operating, it should be the same nearing the end of that fiscal plus new earnings.
Mm-hmm. Correct.
Right.
I'm glad Carolyn's going to explain to us because she's the financial advisor from your
business. Well,
she's thinking about it.
Right. Yeah.
That's what I'm saying. Mm-hmm.
You know, I'll have to. My thought was that we could reduce the assessments by $100,000. But, I mean, we need to talk about it and.
Needs to happen pretty quick.
Yeah. This amount of around $500,000 has been kind of constant over the last couple of years, and it seems like to me an excessive amount of money to be carrying. I don't know what typical town budgets usually have, you know, 10%, 15%. I mean, this is quite a bit more. So
except that we're contributing to the ambulance, so you need to take the ambulance out.
Right.
Zach, right?
Yeah, so that $500,000, there's about half of that is there because it was earmarked for other things to be carried over. So what we're talking about is $250,000, which is broken up. Half of that is extra unanticipated revenue, which we've now included in the budget to expect, and unspent personnel and operating costs.
Well, in my mind, it's legitimate to take out the ambulance, what we're saving for the ambulance. We need to take out what we're anticipating $30,000 for, putting into the building for furniture, which will be expended this next year. And then we should have at least 10% to 20%. And again, we need to talk to as a board, but we should have 10 or 20% of our operating budget in there. And then everything else we should go towards reducing the assessment.
And my issue wasn't the amount. Right. My issue was presentation. So that we can really have a legitimate conversation about what to do.
But I don't think, Jonathan, we've had a huge conversation about that because we've been so new. And
right.
And so I think it is really important that we talk about it. I mean, that's just my idea, what we were talking about, what I just said, is because that seems conservative, you know, relatively conservative. But, you know, we need to, one of the things is you count on revenue. And you can't count on revenue because sometimes there just isn't any calls. And other times there is a lot of calls. So maybe instead of 10% or 15%, or 20%, maybe we want to make it 25% of our budget and then hold that number.
Right.
But everything else, again, should be
too high.
Come back towards the town as, you know, to reduce assessments because, I mean, that was the kind of the idea of doing this is that ultimately it would, you know, be more cost effective to do this.
And I'm more comfortable with the higher number because again, it's not, again, to compare us to towns, towns don't just have free cash, they have a stabilization account.
Yes, that's correct.
So you have to combine those two things when you come up with the percentages that the town is carrying from one year to the next.
Right.
So what I would say is that when you're looking at your revenue, I what I'll say to Kip, I wasn't really a big proponent of looking at everyone, not just Kip. I wasn't a big proponent of looking at the earned or that excess retainage or whatever we call it these days the first couple of years because we had no ideas what was going to happen, up, down, going around. Who the heck knows, okay? I would think that if we looked at it, when we set on our revenue, we estimate what we're going to get back from the ambulance. And I'm going to say 400,000, it's more, but I'm going to say 400,000 for discussion. Well, if we budget 400 and we get 500,000, then we're putting 100,000 goes back in that retainage. Well, we should take that 100,000 and then reduce it from the bill, our assessments to the communities every year, so that we don't want to be making money, I guess.
Right.
And we should, like you said, we should come up with a number that we feel comfortable with, pick a number, and try to hit that number. But if we're getting if we're getting other monies, like on a difference from our...
Reevaluate it every year.
Yeah, right. And use that money, put that money back in to the reduced assessment of the town, that's a perfect way to do that.
Right.
And as soon as we know what that number is that we're comfortable with, then we can maybe whittle that 500,000 up. Because hopefully it appears that we're not going to have to spend $400,000 on a building. But that was one of the reasons I think Mark and others were looking at keeping that number high in case we had to do something. And then we wouldn't have to put the money on a debt. We could just pay for it on these. I think that's what some were thinking at one point.
And I think we should. But I think we should be conservative with our revenue estimates. And I say that because it's not like you can go tell your sales guy to go find five new clients.
Create some more.
I mean, right.
Well, no, but seriously, Jonathan, that is one of the huge issues about the service is because you never know
walking the road.
Really what. I mean, we're very fortunate in our demographics in that we have a lot of private insurance, but you still don't know who you're going to be collecting, who you're going to collect from, who you're picking up, and how many you're going to pick up. So it is really, you need to be conservative. So we just haven't had that discussion, I don't think, as to what we feel comfortable as a percentage of the budget we should be retaining. And so, I mean, if we can talk about it tonight, I mean, that's great.
Well, I don't think we have enough. Maybe I'm wrong. I don't think I know enough to talk about that tonight.
Mm-hmm.
I don't have a problem submitting this budget to the town and come back and modifying it down or hopefully down. But to understand, have a better understanding, what did we estimate for our revenue last year? What did we actually gain in our revenue? That's going to tell us how we're. That's a step in the right direction. Then look at how much money do we have put away for future purchases. Take that right away, put that to, and it's too bad we can't separate that out, like you said, Jonathan, and the stabilization that's earmarked for that, and then find that. That'll tell us how much we have left over. I don't know if we're in a position to do that. Are we tonight? Jack?
To say how much... restate the question?
Okay. So how much in last year's budget?
Yeah.
How much did you estimate that we were going to have in revenue from the ambulance?
$410,000.
Okay. How much did we actually take in last year?
More than that.
Oh, wait, are you talking? You're not talking the current fiscal. You're talking fiscal 16.
Correct. Right.
Okay. The first year of operation.
Second.
No, fiscal 16 was because again, you got to remember it's 2015.
We started
second first full year.
Correct.
Operation.
Right.
Yeah, that was the first full year.
Because we're still in the fiscal year.
Right.
So
right.
We don't know.
Right.
That's why we're going to be, you're right, John, you're working 1 year behind.
Right.
Okay, so 16 was 380,000, and that was the original.
And how much did we bring in? You know offhand?
400 something. I'd have to, not off the top of my head, but.
More than that.
We could get that.
I think it was like 480.
I have it here someplace. It's going to take a second.
That's like 25%.
But if you know that number, and to me, if you know that number, then that number, that difference between what we estimated and we actually took in, we would apply that to the assessment. We would reduce the assessments to the town by that number.
Right.
Would that make sense?
Well, let's set this straight. We have been applying that. Already.
No, absolutely, Bobby.
So everybody understands that.
We're just trying, but now we're trying to refine. So you can start predicting what you're going to be reducing it by.
446,000.
What's that?
446.
Was 16.
Yes.
Versus the 385. So right there, you can do the math, and that, I would say you would apply that to reducing the assessments to the town.
Tom, I think you're on the right track, but again, because we're new,
yep.
Let's not forget we're still a startup.
Absolutely.
I would be a lot more comfortable with using a third year for a three-year average.
Sure.
Because then you can constantly have the most recent three-year average. Mm-hmm. But two-year averages, they're pretty rough.
We use 5 years just because in town, because we have 5 years average.
Right. We don't have that luxury.
That gives us that flexibility, because now we have 5 years.
Maybe right. We could explain that to the FERCog guy, and he could give us some.
Yeah, I was just going to say, maybe, do you think Joe would give us some recommendations?
Absolutely.
If he knows anything about that type of thing.
He would, but he would also help us understand. I think it would be nice if he came to the meeting, because we could talk to him about that enterprise fund maybe a little bit more, and talk about following 2 years behind instead of 1 year.
Yeah.
My question, Joel, to the enterprise fund retained earnings. I think they have limitations on what you can use it for and when they have to be spent by. I don't know if you can carry retained earnings for a long period of time. There was a seminar I put on by the town of Deerfield 2 years ago, specifically on enterprise funds, and there is a PowerPoint presentation that can be given to the board for their review. And it does specifically state what retained earnings can be used for.
Well, the capital isn't an issue. You can do capital. We can.
I didn't say it wasn't.
No.
Saying it's restricted. And the board needs to know that if you have $500,000 and you want to use it for something, but you can't use it because it's restricted.
You know what? How about I will talk to Brenda, and we will get on with the Department of Revenue and get the information, because I do vaguely remember that, Bruce.
I have it at home.
It was a pretty dry presentation.
But again,
it was the question, why does Bruce have it at home?
Why? Because I'm on the Finance Committee and the Sewer Study Committee.
Yeah. I just said it was a very dry presentation.
Hopefully you don't have dry sewers.
But There was, you have to be reasonable, and especially for the ambulance, because it is a cyclical, I mean, it's not guaranteed revenue, it's not like excise tax or something like that.
In this current fiscal budget we're in now, we're using $755,000, including the capital. That's what it says here.
Where are you getting that?
It should be assessment to towns.
Just a quick comment. When on paper, when it looks like you're carrying over $500,000 in free cash, taxpayers do sit up and take notice of that. I've had several people complain about that, of why do they need to carry that much free cash? Just to pass that on. So, and I realize you're absolutely right, Bob, that last year, and hopefully people realize that the assessments were reduced with some of that. And, you know, so the thought process of being able to carry that forward and continue that practice is a good idea, but maybe publicize that a little bit more too. Like I say, on paper, when you see that over $500,000 free cash, you know, that just seems to raise red flags for people.
And Joe Markarian talked about that as far as the bookkeeping on Brenda's end. So you have a line item that says, you know, like operating reserve. So it's obvious what that number is, and it's easier to keep track of. So it's not just sitting there right as a huge number.
And that's a good point. And we don't say enough. And like, there's $250,000 there for the purchase of the next
ambulance.
Mm-hmm. So it's really not $500,000. It's really $250,000.
Right. But what people are seeing on paper,
right? But
there's a lot of money sitting there.
Right, and that's the hard part, and that's what I was saying. That's why it's difficult, because and again, selectmen by nature are very cheap, almost as cheap as Finance Committee members. Maybe not as quite, but what you're trying to do is
I prefer the term frugal.
Frugal. Okay. Selectmen are frugal. But what you want to try to do is we should strive to come up so as soon as like in the town of Sunderland, when we have free cash, we have a formula. Our Finance Committee developed a formula for the use of free cash. one-third goes for this, one-third goes for that, one-third for this. And that way, so when we go to town meeting, we explain, this is why we're using the free cash, this is how it's done by form, and people go, oh, okay, I understand that.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what we should be trying to get there.
Right.
But I kind of agree with Jonathan that we're probably, well, I agree with Jonathan and Kip at the same time. We're not there yet where you can really have that three-year average, but Kip would say, well, you know, $510,000 is a lot of money to be carrying there. And he's right. Mm-hmm. If you have a million, one budget, and you're carrying half a million, people go, really?
Right, yeah.
But it's not. It's like 200, but you can't separate that $250,000 out for capital. I don't know. I don't think.
What makes it a little tricky with that is that you, this particular year, we are buying that ambulance, but, you know, with the revenue source, next year, you know, the contribution to the ambulance, $15,000, so that number won't take that quick dip. And then the second year, now, I don't know, is it a new ambulance every 3 years?
3 years.
3 years. Or five. Is it three or five?
Three, isn't it? Five.
Five, but if you want to do three, I mean, I'm more than that.
I was going to say, let's just three.
Whenever Zach stops talking, that's when it's going into space.
But my point was that this year it is, but it will continue to grow, and that's why, you know, I think that if we come up with a formula like that, that where we could lower the assessments, and then, you know, maybe into their third year, we'll stop, you know, we won't lower the assessments so much.
Right.
You know, then it will start, because we know that another 200 and whatever thousand is going to come out for another ambulance. But it's great that we have that money in there, so you don't have to, you know, look to taxpayers to pay, fit that bill.
A question. Is this year's assessment the same as last year's?
Yes.
Sunderland goes down $5.
Why do they go down 10?
Actually, I think it's more than that because of the numbers on Workman's Comp I got updated this evening. Yeah, so it might go down 12 for you. So I think...
So we've reduced it last year and you're continuing that reduction this year.
Which is a great message.
Yes.
It's a good message.
Yes.
It will be reduced.
Nobody said
that. Don't know how much it's going to reduce yet.
Oh, we're not there yet.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I'm thinking about reducing it again.
Yes,
we may have been spending a lot of time talking about another subject that we haven't been able to talk about this subject, because this is a just as important subject.
But I think it's important to have that conversation at all of our town meetings to say that, you know, not only we got a great service, but the assessment is going down. We're getting a new ambulance that we're not looking to the taxpayers. You know, we've had that
we've
money. And going forward, it looks like it's going to continue to go down. So I think that's good for all our communities.
And by the way, let's not forget what we're here to do is second to none. So the assessments are going down and we still are providing a service that they wouldn't have without such an operation.
I think you also have to look around us. You know, Amherst is their EMS service is stretched to the limit right now. We've been asked to go to help out in other communities and our surrounding communities because of our ambulance. I mean, those are all good things, but it's also some of the things that other towns have to look at right now. Also, they may not be able to be status quo for much longer.
And we want to be very careful. I think we want to be very careful how we move forward with this, and we don't want to grow too fast and get ourselves in trouble trying to take on too much.
I've been very interested in seeing I spent more time looking at the stats for the last couple of years and look at how we went from 802 runs in 2015 to 961 this year and looking at the total number of transports. And to me, that transport number was a big number. This year we had 702 transports in 2015. We've had 594 transports. I mean, transports mean more time, you know, mm-hmm. So... And I look at the call volume, and I think it's not bad to have our people out actually working, but we don't want them.
You want it to be cost effective, and you don't want to burn out your staff for the service that their main focus is providing for the three towns.
And I've been surprised, maybe because I've been coming to South End of town quite a bit more late. I've been surprised how many times I see the Sunderland ambulance coming out of, and sometimes I see the Sunderland ambulance coming out with the lights flashing. That means there's another call already for it. So,
I talked about it last month, about three calls happening at once, and it just happened again the other day at 7:30 in the morning, where there was three calls within 10 minutes.
Yeah. I think
one was a lift assist, one was a car accident that neither of those needed transports, and they were able to go to the third call. And that all happened in Sunderland.
The other thing that is, when you were looking at statistics, it's important to remember that we're not paying for intercepts. We paid for a lot more intercepts in years past. And this past year so far, 2017, we've only had two intercepts. So that's money that we're not paying.
Right.
And that was one of the reasons Deerfield was having such a failure or expense, was because we were having so many intercept costs. We responded, but then we weren't collecting. And then we were also paying for intercepts. And that was really costly. And that's where people forget how, because we weren't a paramedic service and we were responding, we were not able to collect, and we were not, and we were being charged for the intercept costs. And so that was very expensive, hugely not practical. So this is a huge improvement.
So next month we'll have the guy from the FERC out here, and we'll have a host of questions for him.
Well, I think that, do we want?
I think we need to improve the budget with a stipulation that we'll resubmit. The towns in the budget process need to have a number. So I think we need to vote this budget forward, and then have a caveat that we will get a final number once we have had significant enough discussion and agreement on how we want to handle.
That sounds like a motion to me.
When is that going to be, though? Can we put a time frame on that?
Next month.
Yeah, next month, I would think. I mean, we can have ideas, Jonathan.
We're going to vote on this one.
We basically talked about stuff, but it would be really...
So this will be what gets sent to...
This will get sent to the town, so then we can...
Then we can, but
you know,
we can
sometimes
tell
you tell
the
school
committee.
You're going to come back with a different number,
yeah.
And then they come back with
yeah.
a different number.
Yeah.
But we need to, I think we do need more discussion on what we want to keep. And we should be conservative, because we don't want to run into problems. And so having some guidance from Joe McCarrion would be very helpful, I think.
So do you want to bring your treasurer collector also to talk to us about the enterprise with Joe?
Well, what I
so
can do is get
the... So we're
Brenda
on the same
might
page.
Be the better. I'll find out who would be the better person to talk to. Maybe Brenda would be the better person.
So because we want to make sure. I don't care if Joe's here talking about the other stuff, but maybe we all the treasurer and whatever we hear should be the same.
Maybe Joe should talk to her.
No, that's right.
Yeah, well, Joe did talk to Brenda. I know that.
About the enterprise one.
Yes, but I think Brenda is the our town accountant. Versus Barbara.
Yeah, I agree. So you made a motion to accept the budget as presented.
I hear a second.
Second. Well, I'll make the motion. Carolyn can't make a motion.
I can't make a motion.
She can't vote.
I can't vote.
Do I hear a second? Tom
second.
Made the motion.
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor of the budget as presented?
Aye.
Aye. With just the correction that Zach was going to pull out a overtime amount of money, right, Zach?
Yeah.
He's going to refine. He's going to refine the
gonna
presentation.
Find
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Yes.
So for next meeting. Can you have a breakdown of what's in the enterprise fund and retained earnings? Is that what you call it? Retained earnings? Retained earnings?
I believe Brenda called it revenue over expenses, but I don't. I have no idea what these terms of phrase
mean. I'm just confused with. I'm going to have to learn the words.
It's a little bit different for enterprise fund, and I'll talk to Brenda and come. At least with information from Brenda. Okay.
Does that make sense, Jonathan? To have them come in and kind of describe to us, Because I'm a little confused like you about working 2 years behind the...
Yeah, I need to know the process because, and I'm looking at the spreadsheet here, and I apologize for having tuned out some of the conversation because it's very hard to follow. I hate to say it, but it's...
I'm not used to following it the way it's presented. It's
the
I agree. I've gone to see Brenda myself because I find it very difficult to see where how it's all managed.
The labels on the rows don't make sense to the numbers that,
yep.
And it just so I mean the number I'm not trusting the numbers, not to use a double negative. I just it's very hard to plan.
Absolutely. It'd be easier to look, if it was easier to look at and understand instead of trying to figure
then
everything
could,
out. You know,
right, then we could, okay, this is what happened in the past, this is what probably will happen right. In the future, but I can't.
Yeah. And I'm not trying to obfuscate anything, and yeah. I told Joe, if there's an obfuscate...
That's means, a good word.
Thank you.
It's an SAT word.
If there's, please, oh my God, if you've got a budget spreadsheet that is acceptable for the town and everybody else that makes more sense, I am happy. To plug
this
my
may
numbers
be fine. In. I just don't understand it, Zach.
Okay.
And I can't tell you anything different because I don't know how to work within that confines of the enterprise fund.
This are like our highway budget isn't set up like this. No. And that's why when I was looking at ours, I looked at this and I'm like scratching my head and
this got set up by the guy that did that thing. Consultation for us, and maybe that's where it got.
Because this isn't well, the guy. This can't be the way that Deerfield does their budgeting.
Oh, no.
Because
it's
there
not.
Are no, there are no code numbers. There are no, I mean, account numbers. Numbers. Yeah,
no.
This literally is the spreadsheet that was given to me by the acting town administrator from Deerfield to fill in. So, if there's it, please.
Which one of the two?
Please. If there's something else, I'm happy to use it.
No, this was part of the enterprise thing. We'll try to get it better.
I mean, there doesn't. I mean, if we all agree on a different format of that, I don't see that there'd be a problem.
Well, it should go. It should be in line with account numbers. And,
yeah. There's. You know. Yeah. All the bold. Ones have account numbers associated with them.
And they probably tell you how much you spend up the
next
day.
I have that.
Yeah, they should, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, the expense report here, all
here.
Yeah.
There's a way to move this
yeah.
to here.
Right.
And this isn't there.
There's an expense report every month.
I get that, as there should be. It's just the monthly financials.
Right. Finance committee gets it.
That's where we're a little nervous because we've spent 66% of the salary line and we've only gone through 60% of the year. So,
that's to the total budget that we spent.
The
total average.
Total expenditures to date is $704,843.80.
What's the percentage?
The percentage is within 60%.
We're okay.
Yeah, that's
well.
That's time.
Not necessarily, because some of these things come off in chunks, like your benefit packages come off.
The majority of the South County, the Franklin County retirement's already gone out of that. And that's a big chunk of money.
Just our salary line item, we're over on the full time. Our per diem staff is still under that 60%. So it's all.
All right.
Wow. Any other discussions?
The budget? No, so we're going to send that budget to the towns tomorrow.
Yeah, we voted on it.
Okay.
That's so that they have a number to work with, and then we'll have a.
It's a good number to zero. It's
yeah.
A zero, to
zero
that's
increase.
Good.
And so that is a more than we'll refine that based on conversations with Joe.
Yeah, we're going to be exact upon the 27th. So.
Yeah, so about the 27th, which is the date Sunderland has set for the budget presentation. How do we handle that? Certainly I will be there to speak about operational stuff and things like that. Do we need Board of Oversight representation? How do we...
I'll go with you.
That was easy.
I don't know what time you scheduled.
What time is that?
7 p.m. on the 27th of this month.
And that's at Sunderland?
Yep. Town Hall.
Carol can come.
I don't
That's a long ride. She might have to stay overnight.
We can do that. We can put her in the toll house, you know, at the bridge.
I will try to get some more answers.
Mr. Chairman?
I will try to get to be more clarity on some of this stuff that came up tonight.
Motion to adjourn?
Second.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye. Okay.